So first I'd like to start with like, who is this stock for? So Leon did a poll, right? Like many of you are beginners, right? So actually this stock is for you. And some people may have used Arduino before also. So yeah, this stock is also for you. Okay, so start with the basics. What is a Raspberry Pi? So I just copied the definition from Wikipedia. The Raspberry Pi is a series of credit card size computers developed in the UK, so and so, to teach people the basics of programming and computer science. Okay. So there are actually many types of Raspberry Pi here. So don't be alarmed by so many of this. Just if you want to buy a Raspberry Pi today, you get this one. The one at the top right. It's called the Model 3. It's a Pi 3 Model B, which is actually released at the start of this year. There are actually many of these versions, because Raspberry Pi actually started 4 years ago. So they release about one every year. So do not purchase obsolete ones. Yeah, obvious lah. Yeah. Because obsolete ones, they are slower, older, slower, less features. So okay, then also I like to special mention these three. So these three actually they are for special use cases. Here, right, the Model A Plus and the Zero, they are actually a smaller version of the Raspberry Pi. So this is for space constrained applications. Then the compute module here, this is actually for industrial applications. Just for your extra information. So anyway, if you want to buy, just get this. The new one. Okay. So this slide is for those who have some experience in Arduino. Don't have to read through all the specs. But basically, what this shows is that the Raspberry Pi is generally more powerful than that of the Arduino. So the difference between these two is that Arduino is classified as a microcontroller. The Raspberry Pi is classified as a microprocessor. The difference between these two is that microprocessors are usually more powerful than microcontrollers, and they require an operating system to run. So the operating system is usually Linux, but for Raspberry Pi 3, it can run Windows 10 also. For the microcontroller, when you code a piece of program, right, and you send to a microcontroller, that is the only thing that runs in your microcontroller, in your Arduino. But for Raspberry Pi and other types of microprocessors, your code is not the only thing that runs. It still has Linux and other programs running at the same time. So that is the difference. Power consumption-wise, you can see the difference. The Arduino is much less, uses much less power. So if let's say you have a certain battery constraints, right? Like if let's say you have to run a device for many days, then maybe Raspberry Pi is not for you. But if you need something very powerful, then you may need to use the Raspberry Pi instead of the Arduino. Okay. So what's the minimum stuff to get started? Let's say you want to buy a Raspberry Pi 3, that's not the only thing you have to buy, actually. You have to buy a HDMI monitor, or you can use your home TV. If your TV has a HDMI input, also can use that, because the Raspberry Pi outputs the video through a HDMI port here. Then you need a USB keyboard and mouse to interface with it. The power adapter, you need a 2.5A power adapter. So most handphone chargers actually do not output 2.5A. So you need to look carefully which power adapter actually can output this amount of current. So the one thing I tested that works well is actually this iPad one, the iPad charger. Because the iPad charger can output a lot of current, so this seems to work best. If let's say you get those 1A charger, right, your Raspberry Pi may not work properly. Then a micro USB cable, this is to supply power for the power adapter to the Pi. And a micro SD card. So the micro SD card, you can think of it as your small hard disk. This is where you store the Linux OS operating system on it. Then you open your computer to load the initial software onto the SD card. Okay, so I'll go through the steps. Okay, so the step one is you need to download the SD card image. Where do we download it from? Okay, so the download from this website is the Raspbian website here. Okay. So you see, right, Raspberry Pi has many available operating systems for it all this year. But for a beginner, I would recommend that you just choose Raspbian. Raspbian, there are actually two types, the Jesse and Jesse Lite. So the difference between them, that one is out of scope of this talk. So just pick the Raspbian one, the Jesse without the Lite, which means this one here. Okay, so just download it. Then it comes in a zip file, and just unzip the file, so you get this file here. Yeah. Okay, so how do you copy this image over to the SD card? So there's another program, this one here. So this is for Windows. For Mac and Linux, it's another tool altogether. But for this purpose of presentation, I assume all of you are using Windows. Okay? Yeah, Windows has a higher market share, right? Yeah, I'm on a Mac computer also, I'm using Windows here. Okay, so anyway, just download this tool here. Then when you launch the tool, let me show you. Okay. Okay, very small. Okay, never mind. So, yeah. You have to plug the SD card to your computer first. Okay. So you see it shows up here as a G drive. Okay. Actually just be careful that make sure you choose the correct drive. For example, if you put in let's say two or three thumb drives, right, and you're not sure which one, right? So you just go to your computer and verify first lah. So okay, that's the G drive, that refers to my SD card. Okay, so let me just, okay, so this is how you load the image in. Okay, so I'm not going to press write because it takes about 5 to 10 minutes to write the image in. So I've actually already written the image in before this talk. Okay, so when you're done, you just press write. But now I just exit. Need to inject the drive. Okay, so you write the image to SD card this slide. Okay, so now I put the SD card in. Okay, then I will switch the presentation now to the Raspberry Pi already. So I plug up here. So a rule of thumb is that you plug in everything you need first before you plug in the power cable. Okay, so now I power this up. Yep, can capture? Yeah, get rid of it. Okay. Okay, so the first time the Raspberry Pi starts, right? Yeah, it will take some time. Okay, so this is normal, just let it load to completion. Yeah, there's no on and off button there. So just stop the power and it'll start automatically. Okay. So now I'll copy my presentation slides in. See, I can, since there's a USB port there, right? You just put a thumb drive, it will. Okay. Let me copy this thing in. Okay, done. So as usual, like as with any computer, right, you should actually eject the drive properly. So the eject button is here. So now I continue my presentation from the left. Yeah. The top right. This is so you notice that I'm using LibreOffice now because there's no Microsoft Office for Linux. So LibreOffice is a open source, rough open source equivalent of Microsoft Office. There's actually some initial configuration in the code. Wow, I think I have to stand this way. Cannot see. You also can see my Facebook. Okay, so there's actually some steps. So the first thing you have to do, right, is actually to set the Raspberry Pi initial configuration under here, preferences, Raspberry Pi configuration. No. Okay, here. So go to localization, set the location here. So we are not living in Britain, so set to Singapore. Wow. The time zone also. No, not internet yet. Okay, the keyboard. So by default, the keyboard has been set to the UK layout, which we do not want because the UK layout is slightly different. So we set it to the US layout. When you press OK, they ask to reboot. So okay, just reboot up. Let me solve this first. Okay, so you notice that the performance of Raspberry Pi is not that good, right? As a normal computer, desktop computer, because yeah, you can see the size is so much smaller. So a rough equivalent is that of a Pentium 3 and Pentium 4. Those of you who have lived through that time. So that's about 10 years ago, the computer performance. But that's very good, really. Imagine 10 years ago, Pentium 3 and Pentium 4 is how big the desktop. Now you get it in such a small size.
Probably also depends on which operating system that you're using.
Yeah, correct. Right. Also. Okay. So now it's reboot. Let me go back to my presentation. Yes, the LibreOffice is one of the default software inside. Okay, sorry. Okay, so now I'll attempt to connect to the Wi-Fi network. I've actually set up a 3G router over here. So, okay, let me connect to it. So this system update, right, this is actually very similar to your Windows update. So this is something that you should do for a new Raspberry Pi installation, because sometimes there's some security issues. So you want to make sure that your Raspberry Pi is secure. So you download the latest update. But the thing to do this, right, is not as simple as point and click. So you do something through a terminal here. So a terminal here, if some of you may find it similar to like a DOS prompt. But actually this is very powerful for Linux, so it's time to like to learn a bit. So the command to do the update, right, actually there are two of them. Let me see if I can. Okay, can. Okay, good. So actually there's two commands here called the sudo apt-get update and sudo apt-get upgrade. Okay, the difference, So the difference between these two is that here, right, update, right, means to look for new updates. Upgrade is to actually install the updates. Okay, so sudo here means is to run the command apt-get with administrator permissions. Okay, so now let me run this. So this will probably take some time. I just let it run first. If any questions in the meantime? Okay, very good question. What's the sudo password, right? Okay, the default username and password for Raspberry Pi is, okay, username is Pi, the password is Raspberry. Yeah. But you can change it. Okay, it seems quite slow here. Give me one more minute. Yeah, I think never mind. Fine, you take too long. So after this command you run finish, right, then you run this command basically. Sudo apt-get upgrade. Okay, then the next one, available applications. So the applications is not the same as what you're used to. For example, web browser maybe using Internet Explorer, Chrome or Firefox, right? For Raspberry Pi, right, the one they use is called Epiphania. So you just go internet here, then click the web browser. Then, So just maybe Google. Okay, yeah, it looks. So this is the browser. Then, the Office applications, right, just now I mentioned, using LibreOffice. So it's an open source the Office software. Let's see, right here. All this. So the calculator, this is like Excel. Then for PowerPoint, it's actually Impress. The rough equivalence. Therefore, the media player, right, by default, this it does not have a media player, but you can install VLC. The VLC is not installed by default, so the command to use actually is this sudo apt-get install. Oh, sorry. So you just start this command. Then this will install VLC for you. But I will not run it now. Okay, so yeah, the default generally us is Thai Raspberry. Okay, so now it's time to introduce you to you the file system layout. So in Windows, right, you probably see like C drive, D drive, and so on, but Linux doesn't use that. Okay, so I'll just show you here. So you can see here, everything starts from the slash. So this is called a root directory here in Linux. Then for your home directory, it's called slash home slash py or this tilde symbol. These two mean the same thing. So this is where you actually store your documents. Then let's say if you plug in a thumb drive, right, where will it be? It will be under media slash py. So I'll plug in my thumb drive again. So okay, I cancel. Here, media, py, and my thumb drive is here. Okay, so now I'll reject the drive again. Disappearing. Then, okay, of course you're not going to use a Raspberry Pi like a normal computer, right? You want it to interact with the outside world. So there are actually several pins in the, about 26 digital pins here. So the pins are here. I think I'm passing around the version, right? I know where is it now. Yeah, so you can see the pins over there. So these pins allow the Raspberry Pi to interact with external stuff like LEDs, buttons, and so on. And something to take note that this is using 3.3 volt logic levels. So for those familiar with Arduino, right? The logic level refers to like a binary 0 or 1. When a Raspberry Pi wants to output a binary 1, you output a voltage of 3.3 volts. And 0 volts represents a binary logic of 0. But for Arduino, it uses 5 volts. So you cannot actually connect these two together. If you connect these two together, right, when Arduino outputs 5 volts, right, you damage your Raspberry Pi. So this is something to take note of.
Let's confuse the enemy. The Arduino works on 3.3 volts.
Sorry?
The Arduino works on 3.3 volts.
Yeah, some Arduino works on 3.3 volts. But
it's just to confuse people.
Yeah. But for the Arduino Uno, which is actually the most common one, it uses 5 volts as a logic level. Okay, so for this example, right, I'll be using the Python programming language to like to teach you how to use the GPIO pins. So the example I'll be demoing is that of the LED and the button. Okay, so I've connected a button and the LED here to the GPIO pins here.
Do you have to install any special libraries or anything before you...
To interact with the GPIO pins. Actually, the libraries are installed already in the
default.
Yes, in the default image.
Okay.
Okay, I'll demo the code. Check if you can. Just now the desktop. So just now I copied this folder here, getting started with RPi. So the cd command here refers to change directory to go inside here. Okay, the ls means to show what's inside the directory here. Okay, so I put it in the code. Okay, so I'll just show the example first. So the way to run the command is like Python followed by the program that I want to run. Okay, see the LED over there is blinking. So adjust yourself, you cannot see. Like that. So it blinks at an interval of 1 second. So what is this code? So I'll show you the code now. Okay, oh my. Can I adjust the size? No. That's okay, phone.
It says that. 34
of the code. 30, yeah, very good. Really. Yeah, very good. Really. Okay. So this is the code that I use to make the LED blink. So I will not go through everything in the interest of time, but I just show the important parts. Okay. So here the GPR setup means that I initialize the pin that I want to use to blink the LED. So I set it to the output mode. Here. Then here the while through, right, it actually means to loop this again and again, non-stop. Here. So here I put a time sleep, means to pause the program. Then when the program sleeps for 1 second, it will change the LED status and write the new status in. So here, right, I put not is to like to toggle the status from true to false and false to true. So this will do it again and again. Can understand here? Okay, so that is just for the LED. Well, of course, we don't want the Raspberry Pi to keep on outputting stuff. We want to send stuff to the Raspberry Pi. So the next example will be I'm using a button so that I can send things, I can send the instructions to the Raspberry Pi. So the next one is the LED and button. Let me run it. Okay. Let me open the code first. Sorry, feel anything? Oh. Okay, so I just show you the code first before I run it. So you can see here, right? Again, I do the same thing, a loop. And then I read the input of the button. Then when after that, if let's say the button has been pressed, as here, this statement says, if it's true, if the button is pressed, then I'll toggle the LED. Supposed to work, right? So now I'll show you the demo here. You see? It doesn't work so well. Okay, so this is actually a very common mistake. So I'll show you the reason why. See, the reason is because here, when it loops, right, it loops so quickly. Very fast. So it goes through here, and then when you press the button, it detects as, okay, time to toggle, I'll toggle. But the human reaction when you hold down, right, you probably hold down for half a second. But the microprocessor actually loops through this hundreds of thousands of times a second. So that is why this code actually does not work. I'll show you the correct code. Okay. So the correct code is here actually. This actually is called debouncing. Yeah, so I'll show you the demo first. See, when I press. So now it's working well. So it toggles when I press the button. The difference now is this line here. So what this line here is, I've written the command here, change status only if pressed and if time is greater than 0.2 second threshold. What does it mean is that this code here will only run, let's say you press one time, you ignore subsequent input for the next 0.2 seconds. This is to account for the human when you press down, right? You are not like a computer, you don't press instantly. You press and hold down for a few milliseconds. So this is to account for that fact. You can adjust this threshold. Maybe, let's say you press down much longer, you can increase to 1 second. Then the microprocessor will only read the input every second. Okay. But there is another problem. So the code is still running there. I'll show you the task manager here. Okay, why is it not working? Here, task manager. You notice the CPU usage, right, is about 25 to 30%. The Raspberry Pi 3 is a quad-core processor. So when it stays here, 25% CPU usage, it actually means that one of the core is running at full, 100%. This is actually very bad, because you generate a lot of heat. Yeah. So why is this the reason here? So when you come back to this code here, right, you see that same thing, it loops through this very quickly. So the next thing, there's actually the solution, which is number 3. Okay, let me open it. So So the only difference between this number 3, third version of the code, and the previous one is this line here. So every time the code loops through, it will sleep for 0.01 seconds. Okay, so now I'll show you the task manager again. You see the CPU usage is like very negligible. And the response time is still about the same. See, I press the button, about the same. No different from the previous one. So you save a lot of your power and your microprocessor resources.
Right.
So this is something that you should take note of. Doesn't mean something work right. It's actually, doesn't mean you should actually use it. Just be careful of this. Okay.
Okay. Sorry? So there is no code which we can write where it's waiting for
an
input from a human.
Okay. What you're talking about is interrupt. Yep. This function exists, but it's actually outside the scope of this talk. I just want to introduce something simple. For those people using Arduino, right, you may not have actually added this sleep there. Because the Arduino is so low power, right, it's fine to actually just let it run continuously. But for microprocessor, because it's a higher power device, it's advisable not to just let it run continuously. Better to add a delay there. Okay, so this coming to the end, so I just show the one of my projects that I developed with the Raspberry Pi. So this is actually an internet radio streamer. So for your FM radio stations, like for example 91.3, 95, so on, right, they actually have some as a internet radio streams. So I created this project to pull the streams and play that. So I just demo here. Okay, so here, right, 91.3, you can see here. There's a sound here. Then I have a radio station changer here, like Kiss 92, yeah, and I change and so on. Now it's Symphony 92.4. I don't know why not Symphony. Okay, so now it's ES93.3. Okay, so actually the code that I used to do this also written in Python. Yeah, which is actually very similar to the code you saw just now. Just of course much more complicated.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is just to show you that what is possible with Python code. Okay, question, yeah? Python comes by default inside.
Is there also so those are like binary inputs, is there also analog inputs on it?
Sorry, analog inputs?
Analog inputs on it, like a joystick and that type of thing.
That one you have to buy extra, something called a shield, Raspberry Pi shield. It's an attachment. It doesn't come by default. Okay, yeah, some warnings. So, Raspberry Pi does not keep time or power off. So for your computers, normal desktop computers or laptops, right, you take it for granted that when you shut down your computer, you turn it back on, the time is kept, right? But Raspberry Pi, right, there is no battery on it. You see, for most computers, right, it actually has a battery there to keep the time. But Raspberry Pi does not have. So let's say you plug the power off, right, you turn on the power, you plug it back in like 6 hours later, right, your time will be off. So the way to correct this is actually just connect it to a network. The Raspberry Pi will automatically download the correct time from the internet. Then do not connect your current heavy USB devices to it. I know you see a USB port there, right? You may be tempted to plug your phone there to charge, right? I do not recommend that because there's actually a maximum current to it. So here, right, it actually has a fuse, 2.5 amps fuse. So if you actually blow this fuse, right, then yeah, it's not good for Raspberry Pi. So yeah, just don't plug anything heavy to it. If you need to, then you use a USB powered USB hub. Okay? Yeah, that's all. So, any questions?
How do you compile with error about the program file?
Sorry, what do I compile with error?
I mean, you run that logbooks, right?
Yeah.
How do you compile with certain error?
What programming language are you talking about?
Like something like C, let's say you have a compiler that you write that.
I mean, for example, let's say C compiler, if you are using GCC, right? Then when you compile, then they'll tell you the errors at which line.
Yeah,
also has GCC. They have. At least I think so. So let's run. I mean, I can just run GCC here. Yeah, you have GCC here. So let's see what version is this. 492. Yeah. Any more questions?
You run different like OS on it.
Okay.
Is there any way to save
the thing
for?
You can save to your SD card. When you say different OS, do you mean multi-boot or?
Different, like today I want to do Raspbian, tomorrow I want to do
like Windows 10. Just switch the SD card.
Just switch the SD card.
Yeah.
Okay. So you keep just one SD card for one OS.
Yeah, it's recommended that way.
But will the settings be lost or?
What kind of settings are you talking about?
Well,
No, it won't be lost. As long as you save into the root directory, right? The root directory actually is part of the SD card already.
Okay.
Yeah, so any part of the SD card that you boot from, everything is on the SD card. Yeah, it has no other storage.
Okay.
Unless you brought a thumb drive, that's a different story.
Okay.
Yeah, question.
Are there any other type of flavors other than raspberry?
There is. Just now I showed this. Few actually, there's also Arch Linux. You Ubuntu, so,
like,
I'm not sure.
Let's say like it's a pie, right? So
yeah.
Is there any other flavors?
The A plus, the B. Those few. Actually, okay. You're wondering why is there a pie, the name there, right? Actually, it refers to Python. Because the Raspberry Pi was first envisioned, right? They wanted to use Python as the main programming language. So that's why Pi is in the name.
For the opposite, you like monitors and things like that, you run drive an infrared LED to like control a piece of audio, video gear, something like that.
I'm sure they exist, yeah. I mean, I can't say for sure, but it should exist, given the large community. Okay.
Is there a prescribed capacity of the state use?
Minimum, I would say 8 gigabytes. There's no maximum, I'm not sure. There could be a hard coded maximum inside. I've not actually tried. I think just Google for it,
answer. So what's your recommendation, 16?
I've tried 16, 32, 64, they work. But more than that, I'm not sure.
Just depends on how big your program is.
You put a glass 10, it works better than a glass. I've actually tried that.
Any more questions? Okay, the Raspberry Pi is not designed for such applications, but there's, I think some people they did, like for example Raspberry Pi 1, right, which was released 4 years ago, people are still using it today. So I figure it should be pretty quite good lah. But I would not suggest use for industrial applications. In that case, you use the hardened versions or the compute module. The complete module, I think, is designed for this kind of application rather than the full board. Oh, because while it's on, right, I stop it, right? There's no signal to tell it to stop. Turn off. You only change state when I write something to the pin. There you go.
There's also, for me, I use the Raspberry Pi, I think something that most of you probably can relate is that you can use it at the media center. There's this thing called XBMC. It's like Raspbian, instead of actually full OS, it's media center OS. So when you install it, right, and you boot it up, you hook it up to your TV, it becomes a full-blown media center. So you can actually connect to your network, you can stream Netflix, you can do all sorts of illegal stuff.
Home data, yeah.
Okay, so that's actually what I use my one of my Raspberry Pi for, and it's very easy. It's very nice because it actually works with the normal television remote. So a normal television remote would have up, down, left, right, and the up, down, left, right on your television remote would be able to control the Raspberry Pi. So you can go like file, then you just select which movie you want to press enter, and it will actually do that. So this is something that, let's say you want to do something, you just want to get started and do something that is not too technical, this might be something you guys might want to try.
Do you know which version of Raspberry Pi this will work on?
I've used, the one that I'm using is actually a B plus, which is two versions ago. And it works, it plays 1080p video, no problem. So if you go to the raspberrypi.com,
which one you want?
Raspberrypi.org, right? Then you go to where you see the
raspberrypi.org.
Okay, where you see Raspbian, one of it will say XBMC. I think now it's replaced by another name.
Cody, yeah. Cody.
Yeah. So it's actually very simple. You just do what Kheng Meng told you, the Win32 this image, you just put it in, you put it into your Pi, and you just boot up. You don't need a keyboard or mouse, you don't need it.
everything can be from your TV remote. So
I default on that.
And you just throw an FBMT, yeah.
It doesn't apply the IR for you, so it's because the remote is really complicated.
No, it goes to your TV, the TV goes to the HDMI back into the Raspberry Pi. No additional hardware needed.
So it's still hardware because from what I read about the Raspberry Pi, you can install like cameras or do it, etc.
Yes,
yes. So actually, there's actually
a such thing. Like, say if I want to configure Raspberry Pi, say as a CCTV now setup.
There's actually a camera connector, it's called a CSI connector inside. So you can just buy the official module, I think it costs about $35. Then of course you need to write some code to access the camera video stream.
So if you actually Google like what is it, then Google Raspberry Pi CCTV, somebody who has done it before, and then you want, you can go and copy what it is. And usually, and then the Python code, everything will be there for you, just copy what you want. You change to...
Yeah,
they just change to what you want to do.
Okay, nothing else, right?
Yeah, I think we
move
on to scanner.
So, just a word of caution, right? Remember to shut down properly, yeah? So, a Raspberry Pi is like a normal computer, right? Don't just pull the power. I know for Arduino people, you can just pull the power, but Raspberry Pi cannot. So, just shut down. Okay.